We'll start with the next talk, Cyber War on the Horizon, Stefan Schumacher. I'm looking forward to the talk.
Okay. First, I would like to welcome you to my talk, which is titled Cyber War on the Horizon. Before I start with the actual talk, I will give a short introduction of myself. I'm working as a security consultant, and I'm mainly focusing on social engineering, security awareness, counterintelligence, and security management. I'm the president of the Magdeburg Institute of Security Research and editor of our institute's journal, and I'm also the president of the Magdeburg Academic Society of Security Policy Studies. And I've been asked by some political science groups to give some introductions into cyber war, because it is currently being discussed in political science, and I gave them some kind of technical introduction. And now I would like to give some kind of political introduction into cyber war to the technical folks available here at DeepSec. The talk is divided into three parts. The first one is the discussion of the term war. The second one is a short introduction into political topics of cyber war. And the third one is a short overview of currently available attack vectors and how and what the future might bring on the term cyber war. Cyber war is currently a big hype in the media, in the IT security scene, of course also in the military. It's about war, and so the military is interested in it. It's also a big hype in the politics, and of course it's also being discussed by political science. Think of Stuxnet, think of what happened to Georgia and Estonia when they got in conflict with Russia. There was a big denial of service attack on South Korea some years ago. But in my opinion, we should discuss the question if it is really possible to wage a war in cyberspace. So I will give you some kind of theoretical, political, or military science discussion. I will not dig into the deepest technological or technical discussion. When analyzing the term cyber war, we should take a look at the words that are used. Cyber war is composed of cyber and war, and cyber comes from cyberspace. Cyberspace has a technical and a social dimension. The technical dimension means there is a lot of hardware with some software, and I guess I don't have to explain more to the attendants of DeepSec. That's what DeepSec is usually discussing when discussing cyberspace. Cyberspace also has a social component, a social dimension. It is a space where people communicate and live together. Think of communities like Second Life, Facebook, Usenet, MySpace, and so on. That is discussed by social science and psychology, and I'm working on social engineering, security awareness, and such, and I'm discussing that topic in social engineering and security awareness. The second term is war, and that's what I'm interested in discussing here. There is not one single definition of what a war is. The first source to look up when discussing a word is, of course, Wikipedia. So I've chosen the definition of war by Wikipedia. Wikipedia says that a war is an organized violent conflict of extreme aggression between at least two groups with mortality. But there's also another very, very, very famous definition of war. Before I start with that definition, I would like to give an introduction to Karl von Clausewitz. I would like to introduce Karl von Clausewitz. He was born in 1718 in Magdeburg, where I'm from. He joined the Prussian army in 1792, and he joined the Prussian military academy in Berlin in 1801. He rose to become the aide of General Scharnhorst, who reorganized the Prussian army in 1806 when Prussia was defeated by Napoleon and his French army. Actually, he became a general and director of the Prussian Military Academy. And the Prussian Military Academy was a scientific academy to educate Prussian officers, like it is common in almost all modern armies nowadays. Clausewitz died of cholera in 1831, and 1 year after his death, his book On War was published by his widow. On War is a book that discusses a theoretical dialectical, dialectical theoretical discussion of war. So he's the first one who made a scientific analysis of what a war is. He laid a focus on strategy, tactics, and he also coined the term fog of war, which is used nowadays through all kind of information warfare and even is used by computer games as Warcraft and so on. So his book on war is the book on war, the one single Bible on the term war. Karl von Clausewitz defined war, or explained that war is nothing but a duel on an extensive scale. He said, war, therefore, is an act of violence intended to compel our opponent to fulfill our will. This is the essence of war to Clausewitz. He also said, war is a mere continuation of policy by other means. It has no purpose by itself. That means that war is nothing that is done just to have a war, but war also follows a higher aim. War is some kind of political instrument. It is embedded into a political strategy, and that's important, also important when discussing cyber war. The objectives of war to a military leader or to politics are to either achieve limited aims or to disarm an opponent and render him politically helpless or military impotent. That means war is there to suppress or press your will onto your opponent. He also laid a big focus on strategy and tactics. Since I'm using these terms also in my talk, I would like to introduce them. Tactics is the theory of the use of military forces in combat. Strategy is the theory of the use of combats for the object of the war. So winning a single battle is a question of tactics, but winning a war is a question of strategy. Occupying a country and building a new nation is also a strategy. For example, there is a big discussion currently going on what strategy stands behind the invasion in Afghanistan and Iraq, because the political leaders don't have any strategy for occupying the country and building a new nation. And whenever a war is waged or a war is started and ended, strategy is the thing where all military leaders and all other means of war have to orientate on. So without strategy, there is no aim that the war has to fulfill or can fulfill. So to use the Clausewitz theory on cyber war, it means cyber war is a mere continuation of policy by other means. It has no purpose by itself. Cyber war must be embedded into a political strategy to render an opponent military impotent. So the next step to discuss is if it is possible to render an opponent military impotent by just doing cyber attacks, cyber war, or electronic warfare. I think that just doing some hacking can be considered as skirmishing, but not as a strategy or even a complete war. So just hacking around might be fun for some people. It also can be considered as skirmishing in military terms, but with the lack of strategy, it cannot be considered to be a war. In my opinion, cyber war currently is a part of conventional warfare on tactical level. So it might be used to support a conventional war, but it cannot be a war on its own or even a class of war on its own. There is one. Yesterday I gave an interview to a guy from the radio, and we had a discussion on how cyber war might change the fundamental Clausewitzian paradigm, or a paradigm that has been used in military for several hundred years. That paradigm is, it is easier to defend than to attack. Whenever a military group is trying to attack a fortress or something like that, there is the rule of thumb that there have to be at least three times more attackers than defenders. And the attacker has to put in more energy and more men and more machines and more people to attack a defended fortress. The defender is always in advance because he has well-established logistics, he has knowledge of the area, and he can avoid the fog of war. He has more information about the area he is living in, he knows where his fortresses are, he knows the range of his weapons and where he can shoot and fire at. When talking of cyber war or cyber attacks, this paradigm changes because in cyber war or cyber defense, the defender has to defend all system, and to doing that or for accompanying that aim, he has to find and patch all vulnerabilities. The attacker only has to find one vulnerability. So the defender is in charge to defend his whole systems with a lot of unknown security issues, and he has to find them all and close those security holes. But the attacker only has to find one vulnerability. There can be statistic formula can be used to do some statistical analysis of that topic, and there is a paper issued by the University of Dresden. They have done that. They've created a mathematical formula on where you can calculate how many defenders you will need to defend a system and how many attacker it will require to find one security hole to take over the system. And as a rule of thumb, you can say you will need 10 times more defenders than attackers. So I said once in a discussion that a 14-year-old Pakistani script kiddie might be able to shut down the United States Air Force and start a cyber war. That's what might be happening in the future. And this will have important political implications. The politics and the armies are currently discussing that topic, and the military leaders and politicians are, of course, afraid that this thing might be happen. I will now give a short overview on political implications of that topic. When discussing war and warfare, the public international law applies. Unfortunately, there is no international treaty available that establishes a legal definition for an act of cyber aggression. All those treaties have been made in the beginning of the First World War or after the end of the Second World War. So all treaties are about conventional warfare. The law of armed conflict, also known as international humanitarian law, applies to all warfare. There are two parts of these laws called jus ad bellum and jus ad bello, which is Latin and means justice to war and justice in war. Justice to war means how to proceed to a state of war. When are states allowed to start a war against another state? Actually, all these treaties, the term war is never used, and therefore, for example, in the United Nations Charter, no wars apply or no wars happen or take place. They only use the word of armed conflict. So this jus ad bellum has to discuss when you are allowed or when a country is allowed to defend against cyber aggression and to get such a law, it is also possible, or it is also required to get a definition of what a cyber aggression is. And the second point of that law, law of armed conflict, is justice in war. These are the rules of how to conduct a war. The most known laws of justice in war are, for example, the Geneva Convention, or the law of the Red Cross, for example, that medics carrying a Red Cross shall not be attacked. And this law has also to be extended to cyber war and the cyberspace. So, for example, the Geneva Convention might also be used or applied to the computer systems of a hospital. So, one party or one country that is attacking another country shall not be allowed to attack hospital computer systems and such. Actually, as with each and every law, laws have to be interpreted. And of course, there are different interpretations of the current law of armed conflict. The currently generally accepted interpretations say that cyber attacks are not an act of war, and therefore a country is not allowed to react with a conventional warfare. So if one country attacks another country with a cyber attack, the attack country is not allowed to start its air force and bomb down the capital of the aggressor. And there's also another point that has to be met. To be an act of war, cyber attacks have to be conducted by governmental organizations, or at least have to be supported by them. If there is no governmental organization involved in the attack, it cannot be an act of war, even if the attacked country is completely shut down. So if private persons or maybe organized crime or the mafia, yakuza or something else is attacking another country, this can never ever be an act of war, even if the attack country is completely shut down. This is only an act of criminal, and this can only be punished by criminal, by law enforcement communities, by police, and not by armies. Another point that is currently on discussion is non-proliferation of cyber weapons. A friend of mine is currently writing his PhD thesis in political science about non-proliferation of nuclear weapons, and he also has a chapter of non-proliferation of cyber weapons. So I helped him with some technical background. And to enforce non-proliferation on an international level, international non-proliferation treaties are required. One example for that is the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty that, for example, forbids countries who already have nuclear weapons to sell them to other countries who not already have nuclear weapons. That's the treaty that allows the United States to block trading or to establish trading embargoes to Iran, Northern Korea, or Iraq. Some lawyers and political scientists are interested in establishing some kind of non-proliferation treaty. There have already consultations begun, for example, between the NATO and the US and Russia and China, and they're currently discussing how to establish an international non-proliferation treaty for cyber weapons. But from the hacker or technical point of view, non-proliferation can almost not be enforced because the internet cannot really be censored, and cyber weapons can be smuggled on, for example, SD disk or compact flash cards. So it's very hard to actually enforce a trading ban on cyber weapons. And a cyber weapon can be any Linux distribution or BSD version or even Microsoft Windows with Nmap installed or something like that. And nuclear weapons and nuclear power plants are big plants. They use big sites, and there is a lot of machines are required to build in a nuclear power plant or nuclear weapon, but cyber weapons can be smuggled with on any laptop hard disk. And so it's very, very hard to physically enforce non-proliferation. Cyber war is, of course, also currently discussed in the NATO, and the United States want to change the NATO treaty to allow conventional military reactions to cyber attacks. That would mean, to my before given example, that 14-year-old Pakistani script kiddie might be able to shut down the US Air Force, pretending to be Chinese and provoking a conventional attack of China by all NATO members. And that would mean that we would, within one day, start a third world war, because all NATO states are required to support the United States if the NATO treaty is change to allow conventional military reactions to cyber attacks. And as we know in the hacking scene, IP spoofing and such is quite easily done, so any well-trained hacker might be able to spoof another identity and to spoof to being from another country, so he might be able to wage a cyber attack that is assumed to coming from some other country than he lives in. And I guess that might happen even by other military organizations or secret services or such. So changing the NATO treaty to allow conventional military reactions is, in my opinion, a big, big mistake, because that might really lead to a third world war, or at least to some bigger military problems. There is another talk on DeepSec on cyber war versus cyber crime. I've also taken one slide on cyber crime because legal definitions of cyber war and cyber crime have to be made. In my opinion, cyber crime is currently more dangerous than cyber war. All discussions about cyber war are more or less on a theoretical level, not on a practical, because there is currently no possibility to wage a cyber war in real life. An international cyber crime convention is required. There are international crime conventions established, like INPOL and Europol and such, and there is also an international anti-cyber crime agency required that is allowed to act in cases of cyber crime, because usually military powers or military forces are not allowed to react to cyber crime or crime at all. And that's a point where the lawyers have to create and establish treaties that bring the countries and their discussions together. Yeah. The third part of the talk will give an overview of attack vectors, and I will take a more political analysis of, for example, Stuxnet. Yeah, I guess Stuxnet is known to anyone here on DeepSec. It's a worm that has been created by some very good programmers to possibly attack the Iranian nuclear program. There has been an analysis of Stuxnet, a technical analysis of Stuxnet made by Symantec. It's available online as a PDF file, and the analysts said that Stuxnet was really expensive. It costs several hundred thousand or million, up to $1 million, and they required several good programmers and the management. So it's Stuxnet has not been programmed by a 14-year-old script kiddie, but it has been made by a well-organized group, probably a military group or a secret service or something like that, intelligence agency. The developers of Stuxnet required a testbed, including industrial computers and control devices, which are very expensive and cannot be bought in a supermarket. They have to be bought from big industrial firms and companies. Additionally, the Stuxnet developer used multiple zero-day exploits, which are expensive to find or even more expensive to buy. There is a lot of cybercrime going on, and some hacker groups are selling exploits to anyone who is interested in them and willing to pay for them. And the analysts say that the guys who created Stuxnet possibly bought several zero-day exploits with exclusive rights, and this is very expensive. It costs several million dollars to buy such a zero-day exploit, especially for very specialized industrial control computers, which are not that common. Additionally, Stuxnet used multiple intrusion vectors, including USB sticks, on very sensitive areas like nuclear research plants. It has been confirmed in the media that the nuclear power plant in Bushehr in Iran has been infected by Stuxnet. And that means that some kind of James Bond agent invaded or intruded the Bushehr power plant and dropped some USB sticks there, or transferred Stuxnet to the control computers there, because all those control computers are not connected to the internet. So they had to use another intrusion vector. And all this analysis came to the conclusion that this is not the work of some hacking group or some amateurs, but of professional, well-organized group, possibly military or intelligence agencies. So this one put the discussion on cyber war, Stuxnet put the discussion on cyber war on a technical new level, and also on a political new level. Stuxnet is, of course, a well-organized, strategically planned act of aggression. But the question when discussing it with Clausewitz is, did it disarm an opponent and render him politically helpless or military impotent? Stuxnet might have harmed the Iranian nuclear power plant program, but it neither did render the Iran politically helpless or military impotent. And as far as it is known in the media, Stuxnet failed in that way that it was discovered and was not able to shut down the uranium production lines that stand or are used in Bushehr. So actually, if there ever was a strategic aim to shut down the Iranian nuclear power program, Stuxnet completely failed. So I would say that Stuxnet is a well-organized hacking attack on a maybe a tactical level, but it's not actually a part of cyber war or cyber war on its own. There is another attack vector that will give us a lot of fun in the future or nearby future. The attack vector is called smart meters. The European community wants intelligent electricity meters in all households in the whole European Union. Remote meters are used to measure the detailed amount of power consumption per household. The intention by the European community is to help save electric load and gather information for power plants. There is the term of intelligent power nets, which are currently in development, and the industry and the power plants are interested in so-called smart meters. Smart meter allow power plants to remotely shut down a complete household and take them off the power consumption net. This is usually of interest for the power plants, so they can take off customers who don't pay for their consumed electricity, and they can be shut down with just a push of a button or just a remote login, and they cannot get any electric power anymore. But as one might already think, that the whole security discussion has never ever been applied to smart meters. There is a somewhat theoretical kind of attack. If a lot of households are shut down at the same time, the cut of current might shut down the local power plant. So if you take out a town like Vienna or Berlin or Paris or London, the local power plants will shut down or even explode because there's a very high current shutdown. The shutdown of one local power plant produces more cut of current, so the power plants attached or cascaded after the local power plant might also shut down. And that would can create a cascading effect to the next power plants. And almost all European power plants are cascaded into one single network. So with shutting down enough households, one might be able to shut down the whole European power plant network, and thus leaving the whole European Union without any electricity. Another interesting point for the strategist or political scientist is the backup systems rely on natural gas. And almost all parts of the European Union rely on natural gas that is supplied by one single country, Russia. So one might think of a cyber war in the future or an attack in the future where one country shuts down the whole electricity in Europe and then simply cuts down the natural gas supply. And if this is done during winter, maybe on Christmas, we will have a big problem in Europe. North Italy was shut down by an accident and a cascading effect some years ago. It was not a cyber war attack, and no smart meters were involved in that scene, but there was an accident in a power plant and that created a cascading effect, so several other power plants were shut down, and the European power network had to cut off North Italy from its lines. So they also used some kind of demilitarized zone and firewalls in the power plants and the power network, and they had to cut off North Italy and leave it without electricity for some hours or even a day. So this already happened. And some years ago, there was a big power failure in the US where several power plants were also shut down. But that was also not done by smart meters and cyber war, but still by it was applied to old technology and other problems in the US power network. I had a discussion with some guys from the Vienna Technical University, which are just analyzing smart meters. And currently, there is absolutely no IT security involved in the process. Smart meters are usually designed by electrical engineers, and they don't have, I wouldn't say they have any clue of security, but they don't discuss or keep IT security in mind. They're interested in electrical security, which is, of course, also a big topic, but all these smart meters are remote controllable, and they don't think of how to prevent smart meters from getting shut down by a denial of service attack, or how to prevent smart meters to become a botnet. In the UK, the United Kingdom smart meters are currently rolled out, and there are about 47 million households. And Ross Anderson, a professor of IT security at Cambridge, wrote a paper on that topic. And he said those 47 million smart meters might be turned into a botnet, because they are, of course, accessible via internet. And they can attack any other IT system or an internet part in the UK. For the political scientists, there's another interesting point. A lot of power companies and industrial companies can make a lot of money. And therefore, they are lobbying for the introduction of smart meters. As with every political process, the industry is interested in getting laws that help them, and currently they are lobbying to the introduction of smart meters. And the politicians usually don't have that clue on IT security, cyber war, and such. And so I think that smart meters will be introduced very soon, or they are currently already being introduced in some countries. The smart meters are bloated by producers like Amex to make them expensive. If we are all forced to buy a smart meter, then it is very, very good for the producers to make smart meters as expensive as possible, because we are forced to buy them. So they will get a cash cow to make money from. And in my opinion, that process needs to be analyzed by political science. But unfortunately, political science, at least in Germany, has some kind of fear of technology. And they are discussing Cold War themes and topics and such, but they are not interested in technological problems. And on the other hand, the hacker scene or IT security is not that much interested in political processes. So in my opinion, political science, IT security science, and hackers have to work together on that processes. I will give another short outlook on other attack vectors that might show up in the future. Network-centric warfare is currently a central doctrine of the United States Armed Forces. The concept of network-centric warfare was created in 1995. The first paper on network-centric warfare was published. And network-centric warfare is the idea of using data warehousing technology in the army. So the general who created that concept said the IT has given new ways to work to the economy, to the economic science, during the 80s. So that part of business informatics or business computer science, those concepts could be taken over and used by the military. So they want to use data warehousing, which heavily relies on electronic communication. One idea or one concept of network-centric warfare is that each and every soldier gets an uplink and a downlink to his command. So even the lowest ranking private that is running around with an assault rifle in a forest will have some kind of PDA or head-up display, which is uplinked via satellite to his commander, and he will also have a downlink to get commands from or orders from his commander. And as you might see, the whole concept of network-centric warfare heavily relies on electronic communication. And as we all know, electronic communication can be hacked, and it can be hacked in a way that military units are unable to act. So you can shut down maybe an armored brigade of the US Marines by simply hacking the uplink and downlink. Or you can even use a man-in-the-middle attack to give them fake orders, to order them to another part of country or something like that. Robotic warfare is also currently a big topic in the cyber war scene. All military or at least all industrial states are currently developing robotic warfare weapons. Surveillance drones are currently used in Afghanistan. They're also used by police forces, for example, in London. The military is very interested in getting some kind of Terminator. And of course, robotic warfare also heavily relies on electronic communication. And this communication can also be hacked. And if robotic warfare weapons or if weapons are electronificated or turned into robots, they can be hacked and taken over by your opponent. And that can be done by, once again, the 14-year-old script kiddie. So your complete armored brigade might be taken over by a well-trained hacker with a laptop and a Linux distribution. There's also another interesting thing. The East German intelligence agency used so-called perspective agents. There was one case in the 1970s where the East German intelligence service installed an agent in the office of the West German chancellor. Günter Guillaume was the name of the East German agent, and Willy Brandt was then the West German chancellor. And that agent was installed 20 years ago. He was set up as a perspective agent. He was sent to West Germany from East Germany, and he was trained to reach a high-ranking position within the political party that the future chancellor was in. And this can also be, you know, this tactic can also be applied to Trojans. So it might be able to roll out a Trojan that works or that keeps quiet for several years. And in some years, when a cyber war is waging or when two countries are arguing with each other, that Trojan might be used by your opponent or by an opponent to shut down several systems or to take over systems. There is a project at my university that is discussing security problems of electronics in car, in automobiles, and they are currently using so much computers and so much electronics in cars that you can actually hacks them and manipulate them. You can even remotely manipulate them. So you could now start to maybe hack a big car manufacturer like Toyota, Volkswagen, Mercedes or something else. And whenever it comes to a war, you could use a big red button to shut down all cars used by your opponent because they have an undiscovered Trojan on their electronic system. So there might be very interesting new toys for all hackers and for the military. So to sum it up, this is my last slide. The term cyber war is, in my opinion, a little bit exaggerated. We currently don't have the possibility to wage a cyber war because it is currently not possible to render an opponent military impotent. But we are working towards a society that relies more and more on IT, electronics, and such. And we have absolutely no international strategy on IT security. So this discussion has to be led further by political science, politicians, by IT security folks. We have to find an international strategy on IT security. And we also have to bring IT security to organizations and engineers that are currently not using or discussing IT security, like the electrical engineers designing power meters and smart meters. We are currently in some kind of experimental phase, like the Air Force or the airplanes have been before the First World War. There are several quotes from generals from France, Germany, and England that said we have absolutely no use for airplanes when the First World War started. And just 20 years later, the Second World War was completely decided by the air forces of the nations. And the same happened, at least in Germany, in the Second World War with the armored warfare, the Panzertruppe. The general Erwin Rommel, also known as the Desert Fox, created a completely new tactics of how to use a panzer or tanks. And he overran France in just 6 weeks. And we are currently in exactly that phase where people are experimenting with the new weapons. And one day there might be that Rommel or someone else who brings a complete new use to IT technology. And therefore, he might change warfare as we currently know it. So my advice is you should have a look at Clausewitz. Clausewitz gives also a lot of good hints on strategy and tactics that are useful if you're into IT security, because most IT security mechanisms or awareness campaigns and such don't have any strategy at all. Another book I suggest to be read by anyone, Josef Weizenbaum. He just published one book. I currently don't know the English title. But it's about the power of computers we attribute to them. And there is another very interesting man, Martin van Krefeld. He is a professor of military science at the University of, if I remember correctly, Tel Aviv. He's living in Israel, and he is currently also discussing how cyber war might change all the Clausewitzian science of war, or how cyber war should be discussed in a scientific way. Clausewitz's book on war is available via Project Gutenberg in German and also in English, so you can find it online as a PDF or text, since it has no copyright on it because it's too old for that. So I'm finished now. I would also like to introduce that I'm a substitute speaker for the night talk. I will give a talk on security awareness, which is a completely different topic. So I will talk about the psychology of security in organizations. And I would like to finish my talk now, and we still have some time left for questions.
So we have some time for questions. First, let me thank you. I think that we start thinking about these issues also as a society is worth it. So yes. I enjoyed the talk, and maybe you have got some questions, the audience. Yeah.
My question is, how far do you think that cyber war could be going on right now as a part of the economic war? Think espionage, think economic espionage, think that kind of stuff.
I think cyber war or electronic warfare is a big, big part and a big integral part of business warfare. And it also has been a part of it before the term cyber war was actually used. So even 20, 30 years ago, electronic warfare was used in economic war for espionage and such. There have been, for example, biddings being interrupted on international projects and There have been cases where electronic warfare has been used to weaken the economy of a country or to do espionage against a company.
Maybe we should stop using the term war for that, as you suggested, yeah. Because I fear that some military hothead might start retaliate, as you already said. So I think it's worthwhile to spread that it's not really, most of these issues are not really war.
Yes.
And so it doesn't, retaliation with real war is a big danger, I think.
Yes.
And so maybe we should start talking about that as criminal acts.
I suggest to use the term electronic warfare on that. So it might be a part of conventional warfare, but cyber war is too exaggerated for it.
Is it warfare? Is it?
Yeah, at least in the German army, it's called electronic warfare. Okay. All the guys who are doing cyber war, and of course radio operators.
Yeah. I think we should start talking about criminal acts, but.
I'm a bit missing the differentiation between cyber crime, cyber terrorism, and cyber war, and I'm not sure about. Warfare in terms of state actors. Right now, my fear is more on the non-state actors, and the attribution problem, which we didn't really mention here.
All the recent international
exercises I've seen didn't use states as the attacker or as the aggressor. Mm. They used non-state actors.
Mm. The differentiation between cyber terror, cyber crime, and cyber war is. As far as I see, only a legal problem, and on a technical level, I don't see that big difference if you are attacked by a terrorist or by a country or by an army. And in political science or in politics, it's only exclusively a legal problem and a problem of treaties that have to be established.
Yes, but.
As far as I know, but I'm not a lawyer.
If you're interpreting it as war, mm-hmm. you might retaliate with real. Rockets or something. So, yeah. I think it really we see that in the newspapers the term cyber war is used very inflationary, and I don't think it is. So I'm with you in this point that today we don't have cyber war. Most of these actors in the game are non-state actors.
Yes. A non-state actors can legally not wage a war, at least nowadays. Maybe they change the treaties.
One question to your example of smart meters. I did not catch why this should be a new threat, because in the end you could switch off parts of the electric network now by hacking the right big switch in the network. Why should I do the hard work and shut down a lot of households when I can shut down all of them at once now and not in the future?
It might be a new attack vector because it depends on how many different smart meters are rolled out. If the whole European Union uses just one single model of smart meter and you will find a security hole in that, you can write a worm or a virus that simply attacks these smart meters with one single security hole. So it might be easier to shut down smart meters than to hack into power plants, but that has to be seen in reality when they are installed and rolled out. This is just a hypothesis.
Yes, I don't believe that it will be such homogeneous that all companies will, all countries will
after,
be the same, but we'll see. Yes.
After the discussions I had with the guys from the technical university and after I got to know which companies are involved in the smart meters, I think there might be big security problems with them, but that has to be checked once they are rolled out.
They are already being rolled out in Austria, for example. If you have a solar photovoltaics system, you get a smart meter today.
Oh, so. Okay, I didn't know that.
Any more questions? And thank you very much. Maybe there is more time for discussions at after lunch or at the break. Thank you very much.